purpose in my previous life was to help educate people about music appreciation, bring a culture of music appreciation, which I did to some extent. I help out a lot with that. This lifetime is a culture of spiritual appreciation, spiritual literacy, spiritual appreciation, the ability, capacity to appreciate spiritual truth. So, for example, with music, it is being able to really appreciate great music is something that you need to work at. You need to spend a lot of time and attention and really get into it. Okay, and then when you do, you find, wow, this is something I can appreciate a lot. Well, even more so with spiritual truth. When you work on spiritual literacy, you become capable of appreciating spiritual truth to a tremendous extent. And it's way better than music appreciation, actually, which is why I've taken a step forward in doing this. But it's similar in that, what do you need to do when you go to a concert, like a symphony concert? Your attention needs to be there. You need to be in appreciation mode, in wow mode. I'm going to be wowed, as you say. I'm ready to be wowed. Okay? And really appreciate it. Same thing with spiritual literacy. Listening to or coming across some spiritual situation, whether it be a video, whether it be someone here in the world, a saint here in the world, some great book, something. You're saying, I am ready to be wowed by this. I can appreciate what's going on. Whereas Jesus said, don't cast pearls before swine. He's talking about this, that most simply can't appreciate it all. And they'll just go, huh, right over their heads, huh? So, spiritual literacy has been my purpose in this world. Is my whole life constantly trying to raise the spiritual literacy of this planet, but not many seem to be very interested in that. There's some. So when you are very spiritually literate, when you can hear some spiritual truth, you say, wow, I can really appreciate that. Just like if you're really musically literate, you can tell a really, really good song when you hear it and really appreciate it. Say, wow, this is just so much better than the other ones that I've listened to, or at least this is a step up, or just, hey, this is something I really like, and I really appreciate it. And it seems to enrich your life in some way. So spiritual literacy is like a concert, actually. It's like attending a concert. Where you are engaged into the wow mode. Wow, this is going to be great. Can't wait. Just think of young people when they go to see a concert. I remember we used to just be so thrilled, like, wow. We're willing to wait all day in line, just to get it close to the stage, and this is just going to be the best thing ever. We were so into it. Well, the same thing, even more so, with a spiritual quote-unquote concert, a situation where you have the opportunity to hear some spiritual transmissions and conveyance. It's just like, wow, this is fantastic. So this is how I see it. It is just, what do you do as an audience member? Just appreciate it. Just enjoy it. Just enjoy. And by enjoying it, you get familiar with it and you gain literacy. This is the secret. This is how I see the spiritual path. The Holy Spirit helped show me this today. And saying, hey, why not just enjoy? Just enjoy. Isn't this the way? So I said, because I was enjoying giving a taping yesterday. I just really enjoyed it. It was tremendous. I got tremendous enjoyment out of it. And the Holy Spirit said, yeah. That's all you need to do, is just enjoy it, and you become more and more attracted to it that way, and leave behind the stuff that isn't really what we really want. And in spiritual literacy, spiritual talk, we hear stuff that seems to turn around, make a huge turnaround in what we used to believe. And it's just like, wow, here's another turnaround. I really like that. Wow, there's another one. And we enjoy this experiencing of having our belief system changed is actually what happens. And this is like a wonderful sort of entertainment and cultural appreciation of having our belief system changed. It's thrilling. I just love it. Just like you hear some new wine, as it were, too, and it just says, "Ah, I hadn't thought of that before. That's great." Wonderful turnaround there. So what would I rather do? Listen to like a really inspired talk, or listen to some great music? Inspired talk's way better, actually. The wow factor is way, way greater. Way greater. But it requires more attention. You have to be more sophisticated with your attention, more disciplined with your attention than listening to music. Absolutely you do. You really have to have this full stop mode where you realize that you're changing your belief system, so the future and your plans for the future, poof, you know, gone. Like, whoa, I'm not sure what I'm going to do now. This has really changed the equation. And just enjoy the changing of the equation like this. It's tremendous. Here's one. Okay. How about firing the world? The world is your employee. Keep that in mind. You hired the world. How about firing it? How about terminating the contract you have with the world? Say, don't need you anymore. You know, when you go apply for a job, are you not hiring a boss? Are you not hiring a boss? Why can't you fire the boss? Let's say, I hear all these people getting fired, laid off. Why can't you say, you know what, boss? I'm going to lay you off as my boss. You're going to be laid off as my boss. Look at it that way. See, this completely changes the equation, doesn't it? You say, you know, world, I'm going to lay you off as my boss. I hired you to be my boss, but I don't need you anymore as my boss. You know, I really don't like how you're, you know, what's going on right now. So, you know, pattern of behavior, which is, I told you, I don't like what's going on. And if you keep this pattern of behavior, I'm going to lay you off as my boss. You can look at it that way, or lay you off as my employee. We're really hiring the world. We're really the boss. Either way you want to look at it. If you think the world's hiring you, you know, but ultimately we're hiring the world as a laborer for us to try and provide the soil for us to change what we are, to change our function, to add to our functioning, to give us more functioning than God gave us, different functioning than God gave us, an additional function, which can never take place, but we've used this world for this purpose. And now we're saying, you know what? We realize it's futile, and yet the world seems to continue on very stoutly as far as trying to, you know, keep us in going in that direction. So we need to say, hey, thanks for the memories, world, but you're now laid off. You're laid off. Will I bring you back? I don't know. Maybe later, but not now. You're officially fired. Terminated. Your contract's been terminated. So here's a huge turnaround. Again, we think that as workers, like, oh, thank you, I gotta go get a job. They're hiring me, I gotta impress them. Why should I impress them? They gotta impress me. The boss has to impress me. I'm hiring a boss. You know, I'm hiring a business. I'm hiring a job. You know, we're the ones should be in control of that. And if you don't like the boss, fire the boss. Don't like the world, fire the world. And there's a lot to not like about this world. This was also shown to me today. And it's a real eye-opener. Real eye-opener. I all this stuff is happening now. The Holy Spirit showed me how it's going to come together. All this stuff, social stuff in the world. And I realized, holy cow, there's really no place for us here. I see what you're getting at, why it's going to get so bad here. If you don't go along, if you don't comply with what you're expected to comply with, which is to become spiritually illiterate, you see? And having gained spiritual literacy, I'm not going to give up spiritual literacy for any reason, that is for sure. Because in its place is what? Confusion. Confusion is in its place. That's, and who, you know, sorry, saying goodbye, I'm firing confusion, terminating the employment of confusion. The trends in the world are becoming very ominous and you know, clicking into place now, saying, uh-oh. It's the worst case scenario. And, you know, we have this sort of vague feeling like, you know, this future, there's something wrong about the way the world's going. But we quite haven't quite figured out. We keep thinking, well, you know, why do I feel this way? Maybe I'm wrong. No, no, and no. There's several elements to what's going to take place in the world. One of them, of course, the biggest one, is that we've been incorporated by the cosmic corporate culture, and we're supposed to comply with that culture. And that culture purpose is for us to be spiritually illiterate. Okay, and for that purpose, they want us to accept all sorts of beliefs, and they expect us to act in a certain way, believe, respond in a certain way, all to cultivate this sheeple-like attitude of spiritual illiteracy. Country bumpkins, everybody here. Just, I shouldn't say that, because country bumpkins can be quite wonderful, but we're supposed to be a bunch of sheeple with spiritual illiteracy, so we don't know. We just obey the, you know, the hierarchy, the masters of cosmic corporate culture, who are telling us how we're supposed to behave, what we're supposed to think, what we're supposed to accept, what we're supposed to reject. You know, in other words, it does our reasoning for us. Okay. We're supposed to allow our reasoning to be done for us by cosmic corporate culture. Yeah, that's no good. That's no good at all. Now, those who disagree, okay, those who want to remain spiritually literate, in fact, advocated, the advocates of spiritual literacy, which I'm certainly one of those, I just sort of projected this into the future and see how's this going to go. And I said, uh-oh, wow, this is really troublesome. Because, for example, if let's say you're giving a talk somewhere and you're talking about spiritual literacy and the various, talking about the cosmic corporate culture, how it's incorporated this planet and how it's going to try and collapse us all into compliance and the various facets that are being used in the way, and you know, you expose the whole thing, bring it to light, and then you talk about salvation and explain, you know, non-duality and all this stuff. Well, they don't take kindly to this at all. And but you figure, well, so what? So what? So what? Free speech, right? No, wrong, 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 and wrong. What will happen, what I saw is going to happen, is there are these, I call it the Red Guard activists, using a term from China's Red Guard, who essentially were in charge of compliance for the centralized bureaucracy, central planning of communist China. The Red Guards were the bullies, and they brought about compliance throughout the whole country. Okay, we figure, oh, okay, well, that was, you know, back then, now, okay. Well, actually, is way worse now, because it's a global compliance. We figure, well, how can global compliance be enforced? Okay, very simple. There are activists all over the world right now. And we say, well, so what? Okay, let's say you're giving a speech somewhere, any place in the world, just about any place. And this speech is something the cosmic corporate culture disagrees with, because you're not being compliance. You're not allowing them to do your thinking for you. Okay. So somebody sees, oh, what is this? Oh, that's not in compliance. So a Red Guard somewhere says, this isn't in compliance. I'm going to to immediately do what I've been trained to do, which is what? Get on social media, okay? And all these activists have these massive, these lists and networks, okay? They're all networked together via social media and the internet. And what they can do is they can within like 10 minutes time or something, very quickly, very, very quickly, they can mobilize a response to, let's say you're giving a talk or a performance in spiritual literacy in some town, some city or something, okay? They say, hey, okay, we don't want this. Okay, so what are we going to do? They send out all these alerts through all these social networks. All the people get on Twitter or whatever, and they send to all their friends, and before you know it, you know, they've been able to say, okay, where is this located? How many activists do we have in this who can get here and quickly enough in this area? And they say, our job is to descend upon this, for instance, a lecture hall or something, place, and begin protesting, okay? And begin recording everybody on their smartphones who attends the lecture. Face recognition, okay? We have face recognition technology in today's world. They will begin intimidating and harassing anybody who attends this, okay? And threatening them. They will begin threatening whoever, rented the lecture hall. They'll be threatening their family. So there'll be a mob. They'll actually have these insta-mobs, it's called, who descend like a mob upon this area and begin to create all sorts of trouble. Now we think, oh, well, call the police, restore order, okay, right? What's the big deal? Okay, here's the big deal. If you have noticed, and I don't know anyone who hasn't really, over the last 50 years, actually, there's been this massive war against the police around the world, great hatred for the police, but it's become more and more and more and more intense. And we've been experiencing this. This isn't by non-purpose. What they are trying to do is intimidate the police so badly through lawsuits, through government investigations, through losing your job, etc., that when certain mobs assemble, they want the police to simply stand down and don't do anything. Okay? They'll be recording everything the police do. They'll be agitating them, and the police will, from all these instances, you know, the police will say, whoa, wait a minute, we don't want to be hated any more than we are. Let's stand down on this one. So what these activists are trying to do is to intimidate the police so badly that the police will decide this isn't worth it to us to protect the free speech and the privacy and the rights of those who come to view this. To spiritual literacy, to enjoy this concert of spiritual literacy, police will decide it's too much trouble and they better not do it. So there's more, you know, they're going to put cameras on the police, so everything they do is going to be videotaped. The bureaucracy is descending upon the police globally. And they won't protect free speech anymore, you see. They won't protect, they'll say, forget it. You know, let the mob do whatever it wants to do. This is their goal. This is their goal, actually. So you're bringing together technology with all the social media and instant notification. You're bringing that together with ideological activists who are noting ideological compliance, who can alert a large mobilization of a mob, and then you have the intimidation of the police who won't stand up for freedom anymore. They've been beaten down so badly. They're struggling to try to maintain their authority, but they have truly been vilified in the media and by various politicians who are in bed with this whole plan, actually. And not enough people are standing up for them, for the police, because to stand up for the police is to stand up for free speech, the right to assemble freely without being threatened, without being intimidated by mobs, you see. And that is what they're after, actually. So you may think, oh, I have free speech, I can go out and give a concert of spiritual literacy anytime I want. Wrong. All it takes is one person, and they'll have some people tracking you. Okay, where are you going? Okay, here. Okay, okay, we're going to mobilize people within 100 miles or 200 miles of this place. Let's get 10,000 people, rabid activists there, a mob, in other words, descending upon this place. Shut it down. Prevent you from intimidate all the people so they won't even attend. They won't even attend. And in this way, they will just intimidate everybody into compliance, like they did in communist China. You know, the story of that is incredibly vicious, what happened there. Here, they're trying to do it a little less violently, you see, where the nobody will raise a finger, but just collapse into compliance. This collapse into compliance is why the police are being targeted and have been targeted quite a bit, where they feel they can't do their job. They don't have the backing of the people of the world to do their job, which is to protect diversity, freedom of speech, diversity of opinion and idea. It's a funny thing that these Red Guards, progressive Red Guards, talk about how progressive and tolerant liberal they are, yet they're completely intolerant of any diversity. Anything that they don't agree with, they want to crush it. I say crush it. No exchange of ideas. No saying let's look at this, and let's hear this. What's going on? No tolerance at all. No tolerance at all. They say you must be in compliance because we've already decided that this cosmic corporate culture is the way to go, and if we don't go this way, we're threatening our very existence or something. And so they feel completely righteous about being completely intolerant. So this was shown to me. I say, wait a minute, and I realize, wow, we're virtually there. We're virtually there. Flash mobs. Flash mobbing is something that's being practiced now all over the world. We've already had all the Arab revolutions, all this. Flash mobs, they're practicing it there to just change regimes, actually, there. But it will expand to religious persecution all over the planet, actually. And there will be mobs descending on various, places where someone is giving a religious talk, a spiritual talk, something that they disagree with. And they will create such an intimidating atmosphere that people will just say, well, I'm staying home. And they'll find out who you are, where you live. They'll start sending mail to you. They'll start intimidating. Just like in California, the people who were the pro-traditional marriage amendment here, they found out all the donors somehow. They I don't know if they that was legally, but they've got the names of everyone who donated to this campaign. And they began a campaign of harassment and intimidation against these people. And have used extreme terror tactics, really. Domestic terror tactics against these people. So this is just showing you what is coming. Is if you say that you're supportive of this, contribute, if you contribute anything, supportive, you will be targeted. You will be targeted by these activists, by these Red Guard activists. And, I was seeing the scenario in the future, and I said, you're right, Holy Spirit. This is absolutely what is happening in this world. Wow. I said, there's not going to be freedom to teach in this world. I said, what a bummer that is. I thought, no, I can go around and you can do your thing. No, you cannot do your thing anymore. You cannot do your thing anymore. Well, we'll just go someplace out of the way. There's no place that's out of the way anymore. And young people are being trained to be these Red Guard activists, just like they were in China, actually. And nobody's really saying much about it. It's happening right in front of our faces. Right? Young people are being taught to be snitches on their parents, on older people, on those who what they claim have backward, counter-revolutionary, counter-corporate, cosmic-corporate cultural ideologies. And they're being taught to say, tell on them, write reports on them, but, record them on their smartphones, actually. They're being taught to record their parents on their smartphones, okay? They're being taught to be good little revolutionary, Red Guards, which they're in the compliance division of this corporation that's taking over this planet. They're in the compliance division. So I saw this. I said, well, that's interesting. I said, well, maybe we can go to some some safe place in the world. Okay, so I said, okay, no problem. Whoops, you know. And then the whole situation with drones came into the picture. Some countries are doing, which is really campaign of assassination using drones. Drones are actually assassins. And I realized that anyone in the world can be targeted by drones now, actually. Wherever you are, how can you keep the drones out? I mean, they could come, you know, from any altitude, straight down. I mean, what are you going to do? How can you keep drones away from you? You see, you can be driving a car anyway, anywhere. They have ways of locating and targeting anybody very, very specifically now with these drones. So even if you're in some other country, you know, or some place that you think is safe, how safe are you really? How safe are you really? Not very safe at all. So we have this situation that nobody is really safe from cosmic corporate culture. They have the technology to hunt you down, to intimidate you, and to use drones on you if they want to, which is taking place with those that you know, they disagree with. Those are non-compliance. Those are non-compliance will, in the future, be targeted for sure. Oh, either that, or they'll try to put as many as possible into re-education centers, but the ones who are, you know, not there, they will simply carry out campaigns of what could be called assassination. Imagine if, like, in the Cold War, like Fidel Castro, if we had drones, you know, back then. I mean, you could just have a submarine off the coast and send drones, a GPS and the whole thing, you know, and just target. It's just ridiculous what they're doing. How they're able to utilize the technology to bring about compliance. To bring about compliance is what they are after here. They want a very smooth running business in this world. Very smooth running business. They don't want any glitches. That is for sure. They don't want spiritual literacy on this planet. That is for sure. That is the number one enemy they have on this planet, is spiritual literacy. Because then people start saying, wait a minute, we don't really need you. We don't really need you here. We don't need you. So when we start saying we don't need you, then they lose the power over us, you see, because we're actually allowing them to come here because we think we need them. They've generated all this crisis on this planet. And then coming in with the so-called remedy. I mean, the crisis on this planet has been generated by technology. For instance, the Green Revolution, which has increased the population of the planet, what, doubled it maybe or more? It didn't need to have that at all. You know, the scarcity of resources, global warming, scarcity of resources, problems with the ecosystem. Why? Too many people. Why? Green Revolution. Using the technology to try and increase the population to such an extreme extent. And increasing the standard of living around the world, so more and more consumption. You know, preventing as many deaths as possible through all sorts of vaccination programs and medication seems great, but also helping, making sure everyone lives a lot longer. All this stuff, you know, all combined of what we've done, it's actually brought about all these crises on the planet. And then they come in and say, hey, you know, we know how to solve these for you. You guys are a mess. You guys are a mess. Well, they're the one who messed it all up in the first place. It's the old standby of create a crisis to make yourself seem indispensable. Okay, this is the standard tactic that they use. That's like Mao Zedong in communist China. When in Tibet, Tibet's eastern province was rebelling against the communization, the turning all their land into communes. And so they launched a rebellion, and Mao said, this is great. Let it get really bad. This is exactly what we want. We want crises. We want crises. And that'll justify us coming in and completely taking over, you see. So the crises in this planet have been intentionally fostered in order as an excuse to be heavy-handed later on. This is one of the central things at play, that the mind actually plans far in advance existence. The existence is just a dream that the mind is imagining, actually. And it strategizes and plans. For instance, guilt is one of the prime dynamics it uses planning ahead. What it does is it tries to set up a guilt situation, so then later on it can use that guilt to manipulate people into compliance with how it wants compliance. So what it'll do is we'll have people pretend to be victimized or pretend to be this way, bothered or subservient or whatever. And then later on they'll say, oh, look how terrible you treated us all these years. All these thousands of years, you depressed us so terribly. Now, so you're guilty, you're super guilty, and now we've decided to press this issue with you for justice. We want justice. And then the guilt, those who feel guilty now will say, oh my gosh, and it'll collapse them into compliance. This is a very common strategy. This is a strategy that's being used right now on this planet, which is what's called radical feminism, is to say the woman's always right, okay? And saying that men are inherently guilty of thousands of years of patriarchal oppression and suppression, and so they're trying to make all men feel like they're inherently carry this massive historical burden of guilt, you see. And then saying, we'll cancel the check, we'll call it good, we'll tear up the check if you just fall into compliance with cosmic corporate culture. Okay, this is the scheme that they're using. And it's very false, because nothing can happen to anyone against their will, actually, at all, as Jesus points out, as true teaching. So if you're trying to generate some guilt, you're doing that for the purpose of using it later on to try to suppress somebody, at least try to scare tactic them into compliance. Now you say, well, nothing can happen against our will. Well, it is true. However, we can be frightened so badly that we make bad choices. Okay, that is also true. But where it's guilt is being used, this is definitely a tactic of cosmic corporate culture, of self-deception, instead of forgiveness. Forgiveness is to forgive ourselves for falling into compliance with insanity. Okay? We made the decision. We scared ourselves. It's a spiritual problem. It's up for us to solve it through forgiveness. But if you don't have a culture of forgiveness like this, you're going to end up getting caught up in this guilt and then thinking that you need to pay for this guilt through your own suppression. See, through your own suppression. This is why we have this whole goddess matriarch cult arising in the world now. It's based on guilt and men feeling that they're bad, they're wrong, they're guilty. And the fact is that if you look at it objectively, realistically, women certainly are able to hold their own with men, and more, and more, and more. In fact, they're quicker. They have capacities to easily dominate men. But what they've done is they make it seem like they've been dominated, building up this huge reservoir of guilt that they can now use against men. Say, hey, guys, you have to go along with this, otherwise, we're going to continually make you feel that you're bad, that you're wrong, okay? But we'll overlook that if you go along with this compliance. So all of this has been schemed by the mind. The mind schemes far, far, far into the future and strategizes, actually. And just sets up this play to continue this self-deception. So we're in the jaws of this right now, actually. Now, cosmic corporate culture knows actually, women are extremely powerful, and actually, most men are simply accepting the values of women. This has always been through, so throughout history. Women have tried to, you know, stay in the background a little bit as they see how things work out. So, well, we don't want to take responsibility for this. Let's see how it turns out. But, you know, like if you're a young man and you're madly in love with a woman, you know, you are going to adopt her values if she presses the issue. She's looking, you say, that kind of turns me away from you, that value. And you say, why? So, well, you know, that's not really very good value. You know, this is better. You say, okay. So men are very, very prone to having their values manipulated by women. And this has been true throughout history and continues to be very, very true at this time. In fact, you know, as men say, you know, you can listen to men talk and they're terrified of taking any stance that they think women won't like. Terrified of it. Why? They don't want to sleep on the couch, plain and simple. This is the trump card, okay? They don't want to be sleeping on the couch for the rest of their life. So they say, whoa, I better get in compliance with that woman, you know. They're frantic to get in compliance with the women. But women keep shifting these values and they're saying, wow, where is this leading us? It's leading us into compliance with cosmic corporate culture is what it's doing. That's the end game. That's the end game of all this social turmoil we've been going through and all these, you know, all this stuff, this activists and pressuring us, is to get us in compliance with cosmic corporate culture. Because those who have a very severe continuity problem believe this is their salvation. So they're really working for their salvation by getting you into compliance. And the cosmic corporate culture is very shrewd, and they know if they can get women on their side, they don't have to get the men on the side. The women will do it for them. And this is exactly what's happened in this world. Exactly. Because we wonder, where are these, you know, evil, you know, cosmic corporate culture thugs that are just, you know, well, they're on the fringes if they're needed. If they're needed, they're here and ready to pounce. But they're trying to do it without that. And how it is the women are getting the men to come into compliance just by saying, hey, you know, you don't want to be on the outs with me, do you? You know, I can make life a living hell for you, which any woman can certainly do for any man, make life a living hell for them. And they do exactly that if you do not accept their values. Most, not all. Some say, hey, you know what? I don't want some weak man who will agree with anything I tell him their values. No, I want them to say, hey, I have different values. This is what I believe. This is what I think. You know, they respect that. But that is going to becoming almost extinct in this world. It used to be that way, where a man could speak his mind and didn't feel threatened by his wife. But now, no man can speak their mind. Like, you listen to people on the radio, they're such utter craven cowards, it's utterly ridiculous. It's just amazing how terrified they are of saying anything that they think that women, their wives, their girlfriends, whatever, significant others might find out. Oh, you think that way? Oh, really? Oh my gosh, I didn't know you did that. That's horrible. No. They say, no, that's not what I really think. And they're trying to say, what do I need to think? Tell me, what do I need to think? And they say, well, you should look at it this way. Oh yeah, okay, this is how I look at it. And they're like overly, you know, you listen to them and they're just like, they're terrified that, you know, that maybe their wives might think that they don't really believe these values. So they overdo it. And out the windows goes reason. Out the window goes common sense. Out the window goes due process, you know. They're trying to get rid of due process. Is what the cosmic corporate culture is trying to get rid of due process. That's why it hates the United States justice system, and it's been trying to collapse that for quite some time. They want you to comply right now. And the way they're doing it is through bureaucracy, through rules, laws, rules and regulations, through social media, through bullying, through your spouse, which is usually the women. It can be the other way too. Pressure, cultural, social pressure to ostracize you, to vilify you, and to drive you into compliance. And they're doing a very successful, effective job, actually, because rarely do you ever hear any man on this planet anymore, you know, stand up and speak freely without fear of retribution. Rarely. I remember I used to hear that. There's some radio program. You occasionally hear it. You say, "What? What is this? How can that guy be talking like that? Isn't he afraid? You know, of being ostracized by all women? Isn't this horrible?" He said, "No, no." Not afraid of being ostracized by truth. That's for sure. That's for sure. So it's this massive combination of factors in the world right now that's collapsing us into compliance. If we're not, I think most everyone's already collapsed into compliance. As a matter of fact, even those people who claim to be spiritual, you never hear them talking out like this, for example. No way. They would not. They can't do it because as soon as they become dependent, their businesses, their outreach upon women, as soon as they, and all it takes is a couple active female activists to say, "Hey, you know, we're going to complain. We feel uncomfortable. The environment is not friendly to us, you know," and they'll start, you know, sabotaging things, and very quickly the message gets through, like, "Hey, we need to get in compliance with what we want. You can keep your title, and you can keep people thinking that you're some nice guru and everything, but you have to be in compliance with what we want." This is exactly, all these spiritual teachers have handlers now, and I'm looking at who are these handlers, and there's all these women, almost all, they're surrounded by women handlers, and that's to make sure that they get into compliance. And I've said this many, many times, and it's becoming more and more and more and more so this way. And the cosmic corporate culture cultists are just biding their time, just waiting until they can make the straw that breaks the camel's back. They're waiting for that moment when they're going to bring something upon this world that'll break this camel's back and pull everyone into zombie-like sheeple compliance with what they want. At that point, I think a lot of women will say, "Uh-oh. I think we've made a very bad deal here, actually." You know, something inside will say, "Whoa, I think we made a huge mistake, a huge, huge mistake." And they most certainly have made a huge, huge mistake. And I've spent my life trying to speak on this, you know, and nobody has my back on this, really. Those who've tried to speak up realize what happens, you know, how they get vilified. But at some point they'll have buyer's regret, big time buyer's regret. And they'll say, "Well, where are all the men to speak up?" Nobody. Nobody. They're sheeple, they're zombies. They'll look around, zombies, you know. And it's no longer safe to speak up anywhere here. And they'll realize they jumped the shark. They jumped the shark. Lesson learned, you know, lesson learned. Hopefully, lesson learned. And the only way out is spiritual literacy, is to start really paying attention and saying, "This is a job I gotta do, whether I like it or not, I have to do this." And get serious about spiritual literacy, real spiritual literacy. And stop this nonsense about peace on earth. Nonsense. And, you know, become a renunciate. Become a renunciate. Absolutely. Drop all the ornamentation. Drop all the ways and means that try to make the body attractive. You know, become a renunciate. Become a renunciate. Accept, support monastic culture, actually. Support monastic culture. Now, when women support monastic culture, then that changes everything. Because then the men feel free to pursue spiritual literacy, you see. And both will feel free, actually. That'll change everything. But until women support monastic culture, this world is going to hell in a handbasket for sure. Because really, women are captain of the ship. Always have been, always will be. And sometimes they pretend not to be, you know, to bring about this guilt card sort of thing. But they're the ones steering the ship, or at least if the man's steering the ship, the woman's telling them where to steer the ship to, actually. They may be several steps removed, but in the background, they're the ones actually in charge of culture, in charge of socialization, in charge of educating the next generations, in charge of, you know, really the whole value system of the world. Absolutely. So when they change to supporting monastic culture, we have a very different situation. Cosmic culture, you know, bye-bye, we don't need you anymore. Cosmic corporate culture, bye-bye, we don't need you anymore. Which is what they're afraid of. They're afraid of, like, oh, we need more slaves, we need more zombies to try and make this world, you know, to develop our new function and make this world more attractive to us in reality. If we fail at that, we're going to be annihilated. It's just horrible, you know. No, that's all lies they're telling themselves, motivational lies, to try and be greater than God, plain and simple. Guess what? We don't have to be greater than God. There's no reason to at all, none whatsoever. God is all. God is everything. We are God. We are. There is no greater than all greatness. We already have all greatness there could ever be. All greatness there could ever be. We already have it right now. Everyone does. All. So it's ridiculous to say we need to be greater than God. We have no such need whatsoever. It's not a need. It's a whim. So the tactics that have been used on this planet, you know, just observing it all, these classic textbook tactics have been used over and over and over. We were warned about those tactics, and yet the reason why they're used over and over again is they work. They work. They work. It took them a while. It took them a while to break down the defenses of this planet, but eventually they did. So, where can you go to give a talk like this in the future? Nowhere. The answer is nowhere. The answer is nowhere on this planet. So how do you bring about spiritual culture, spiritual literacy on this planet? Yeah, it doesn't seem possible. It doesn't seem possible. At least the way I'm seeing it. What's going to happen is you'll get in compliance. Anyone who wants to be seen as spiritual will have to be in compliance with basic ideology of cosmic corporate culture. Say, we're bringing peace on earth here. We're bringing happiness, you know, equality, fairness, equality, tolerance, peace on earth. And we're getting everybody on the same page. We're going to fix all the problems. We're going to restore this planet to a radiant, beautiful, lovely planet. And all this kind of ideology, you see, you're going to have to go along with that. And then you can maintain your title or, you know, whatever. But they'll probably find some way to, you know, create a scandal. They're very good at that, generating scandals, false allegations. It's interesting, another thing they do, the Chinese have already worked on this for a long time. And so they've taught the rest of the world, they've taught all the 60s revolutionaries and subversives. The 60s, I lived through the 60s and the 70s. They, you know, a lot of people in the 60s actually had a little red book, the Chairman Mao's book, and they studied it. Those were the political activists. So they've been taught very well these sorts of tactics. And we have now the leadership, you know, the world is very much understands these tactics. And here's a tactic that's used is, let's say you're falsely accused of something, and you go through this big effort to clear your name and find the authorities to say, no, there's no evidence, there's no charges, no evidence, there's no stain in your reputation or anything like that. And then someone else later on brings up another false accusation. And then someone comes along and says, hey, wait a minute, we see a pattern of behavior here. We don't like that, we're going to terminate your job. Pattern of behavior. Wait a minute. Say, wait a minute. And say, yeah, we don't like this. See, there's a pattern. Wait, the first situation was seen to be a false allegation, so there was no pattern of behavior started there at all. So the second instance, which is another false allegation, how can you link that to the first instance and claim it's a pattern? How can one instance be a pattern? It can't. But what they do is they use the previous false allegation or allegations to claim that this constitutes a pattern of bad decisions. Wait a minute. If someone targeted me and made false allegations, how is that a pattern of bad decision on my part, you see? And these are the kind of tactics that they use. So even if you're completely innocent, the false allegations will make you seem that there's a pattern of bad decisions on your part. So there's nowhere to run and hide from this situation right now. Just like in China, look how successful the Chinese were, the communists, of suppressing the entire country, of driving out the Tibetans from their country. Very successful, super successful. And this pattern, this program is very successful, actually. The only thing holding it back is the Americans are armed. So many Americans have firearms, you know, the right to bear arms. This is something that they're desperately trying to get around. This is something the founders made sure was put in the Constitution to avoid this kind of sort of situation that's coming. So they'll make ammunition impossible to get. You know, like what they're doing is they're actually giving all children now, they're planning to do this, is to give them psychological testing. And anyone who falls under the category of occasional depressive episodes, it will be a permanent part of their database where they will not be able to purchase or own firearms in the future. And so they have this test that they're giving children. And I looked at the test, and the questions they ask you, you know, any child at some point in time will answer yes to all those questions. You occasionally feel down. You occasionally feel anxious about the future. Every child growing up is going to say, yeah, I experienced that sometime. I have some struggle sometime. So what they're doing is they're casting this wide net where they can basically claim that all children are potential depressives in the future. And therefore, none of them have the right to bear firearms. This is what they're doing. They claim, well, you have potential for some mental illness. You see, they're trying to identify who has the potential. But the questionnaires and the way the testing they're doing is, again, basically all children will fall into that category. Occasionally I feel, you know, like maybe I want to die, you know. I just feel so, you know, I feel angry at people sometimes. Of course, as you're growing up as a child, you're going to go through all sorts of ups and downs and stuff. And they're caught saying, this is the red flags. And they're flagging everybody. They're going to flag everybody. Permanently on your database. This is just one of a galaxy of stuff that's going on this planet right now. Citizens in this country, if they feel that they're, you know, danger to the country, you can attack them through drones, actually, with no due process. This is already the law in this land. No due process. It's just on the discretion of the hierarchy, of, you know, the bureaucratic hierarchy, upon their discretion, without any due process whatsoever, American citizens can be both targeted here and abroad for assassination. Okay. So this is just another one of many, 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 many factors that people are realizing and saying, you know, wow, what's going on here? And what I'm saying is the takeover of this planet by cosmic corporate culture, which is an ideology whose purpose is to get rid of spiritual literacy, get rid of it. Now you may think, well, what's the big deal? Okay, let's just get in compliance. And of course, what they do is they hold up these snake-handling evangelicals or whatever, speaking in tongues, snake-handling people, and say, you see, no, we just want to get rid of that. You know, this, you know, just join us, won't you? They're trying to, you know, impose their values upon us, these people. So what they do is they bring up the most frightful examples they possibly can to people to scare them. And say, no, we're just here to get rid of that and make you safe. Now, that's not a big deal. We're just asking them to come in compliance with that sort of thing. You know, we don't want you to be literate in that way. That's backwards, right? And people say, oh, yeah, okay. This is what they've been doing. and then what they do is then they paint with a broad brush, and you're guilty by association. So if you're spiritual or religious in any way, people immediately associate in their minds now, and those who have been brainwashed, into, oh, this is these crazy, these people are like these crazy snake handling, speaking in tongues, dangerous, you know, hateful people. Wow, that's terrible, we gotta get rid of them. Guilt by association, by painting this broad associative brush, which is part of the brainwashing technique which has been used in the news, in the media, the television, the media, news, all these people are actually brainwashing experts, a lot of them, brainwashing experts. They know how to create associative sort of thinking, okay, and that falls into these traps of confusion. Sheeple, okay, they're making sheeple, easily controlled. And so they want to get rid of spiritual literacy. This is what I'm pointing out. Which means they want you to be confused. Which means they want you to be unable to make distinction between truth and lies. Because again, they're fundamental, they're being driven by this incredibly insane fear. Fear of having no function. Okay. Because when we attempted to be greater than God, we said, well, how can we be different? We have to show that we can create another reality, separate reality. Oh, it has to be different than reality. What's reality? Absolute freedom. So what could be different from that? Lack of freedom. Well, what's lack of freedom mean? Means moments are joined together. Either moments are joined together or they're not. So the only place to go from reality to make a separate, different reality is to say that moments are joined, which is why we have what we call nature, the universe. This is our attempt to create a separate reality so that we're greater, greater than God. And we created ourselves. Okay. So, in doing this, we feel that life is structured, and that our functionality is a structured functionality. We're not free, that we're part of this vast structure, this vast dynamic we call nature. And this is what determines what we do, how we feel, what we are, actually. So, to realize that none of this is true, it's only a hallucination, we would feel that, wait a minute, where's my functionality? I just lost all my functionality. And so, they equate this with annihilation. But what happens is actually you're returning to your true functionality, which is perfect functionality, which is actually total access to everything, always. Total access to all experience, always. Whatever you want, everyone has this. So you're simply returning to true functionality. You're not losing functionality. But they don't realize this. This is spiritual ignorance. Okay, they have so much continuity fear that they're prizing ignorance and spiritual illiteracy above all else, because they don't want to even know that we can set this dream down. They want us to believe that it's dreaming us, that this dream is actually dreaming us. That's what they want you to believe. So this is what they export. This is why they're desperate to incorporate whatever they can see. They've got to gobble this up, got to incorporate this. This is threatening. This threatens us. The freedom of expression, freedom of thought. This threatens us. This threatens us. This threatens us. We have to gobble that up and get rid of any sort of spiritual, religious truth. Get rid of it. Because they feel it threatens them with total non-functionality. Thinking again that structure is functionality, which is total illusion, delusion. So that in a nutshell is what's happening. And this is very well known, of course, to cosmic spiritual culture. This is the primary problem that we have. And so we need to enhance our spiritual literacy, enhance it, which is what I've tried to do in my life. Because it wasn't sufficient to withstand what's taking place in this world. I said, wow, we're really up against it here. We really have to enhance our spiritual literacy. So all thanks to those who have shared their great spiritual literacy with the world. Okay, like a Ramana Maharshi, like a Sri Sri Anandamayi, like a Longchenpa, like a Jesus Christ, like a Buddha, etc., etc. Who have shared their great spiritual literacy with the world. and enabled us, those who want to, you know, enhance our spiritual literacy by paying attention to all this. So, for my example, I'm way more spiritually literate than I was coming into this world. Way, way more. And as far as coming into this world, that's a big mistake, isn't it? The people here say we're so disempowered to become more spiritually illiterate, thinking that that's empowerment. As I always say, this world, they believe that failure is success, meaning they want to become less spiritually literate. So what they really want to do is they want to tear down clarity, spiritual literacy and clarity. So they want those to come in the world with clarity, spiritual clarity and literacy, and then they want to work to tear them down, and this makes them feel safer. You say, oh, we got rid of that, we got rid of this. Okay, great. We're making progress. And so I made the mistake of thinking the world really wants help here. They really want spiritual literacy. No, they don't. They want to tear it down, actually. They want to tear it down. They want you to be their punching bag so they can exercise their confusion on and make themselves feel that they're greater. You know, look at this. And one of the tricks they use is they try to make you feel guilty by saying that by your saying, no, I want clarity. They say, oh, you're trying to be greater than us, huh? You think you're better than us. I say, actually not, because all I'm doing is expressing our natural God-created functionality. It's those who seek confusion who are trying to be greater than others. Those are the ones who are trying to be greater than others. If you're confused, that means you're trying to be greater than God, greater than spirit, greater than reality, trying to be greater than others, so to speak. That is the truth. So it's the ones who are confused who are pursuing superiority, okay? Who are trying to be greater than others. They're the ones who are against equality, actually. They claim equality. They say, let's everybody be confused. That's equality. That's their idea of equality. What it really means, let's everybody decide that we'll all try to be greater than God, greater than spirit, you see? Be unequal. They're really pursuing inequality. So I got tricked, I got deceived, you know, in thinking, you know, they really want to be helped here. Very few really want to be helped here, actually. Most want, they believe help is confusion, is they want to strengthen their confusion. So they want people who can teach truly, but then they want to be able to confuse them in their mind, say, okay, look, I'm better than them because I was able to take truth and confuse it in my mind. And they say, oh, that's a great triumph, you know, it's a great triumph. How about that? So, like for instance, when I was studying A Course in Miracles, I was reading, and then suddenly I said, wait a minute, let me go back a couple sentences. I threw a word in there, I changed the meaning, and then sure enough, I go back and I read it again, and I said, well, my gosh, I knew that something was wrong, I completely twisted the sentence structure. So I found that this happened over and over and over again, and it still happens a little bit. Where I'm reading, say, catch it, wait. That wasn't there. I added a letter, and I changed the meaning, or I dropped a word out or something, you know. But I was very good at catching this. And I said, hey, something doesn't sound right, because I'm reading truth, and suddenly it doesn't feel like truth to me. And I'd go back, and I'd find I had distorted it, okay? And so I realized there's that capacity within us to distort truth. In fact, we're experts at distorting truth. Everybody here is experts at it. So you can say yes, and they'll say, oh, they'll hear no. Literally. You'll say yes, and they'll hear no. And they say, oh, you said no. Okay, great. Now we understand. And then you say, no, I said yes. They say, wait a minute, you're disagreeing with yourself now. You know? So what people here are so skillful in is confusion. This confusing situation. So you'll say something, yes, and they'll say, okay, no, and then they'll draw conclusions, and you'll say, wait a minute, that's not what I said. I said yes. I said no, you didn't. You said no. And then they say, I said yes. Well, they say, no, you didn't, but now you're disagreeing with yourself, so you're really confusing me. You're a teacher of confusion, aren't you? And they completely flip things upside down like that. This is what I've experienced in my whole life. This is what I've experienced, is this. There's this very skillful in confusion. Unrepentant. You see, now when you're repentant, you catch your own mistakes. This is what A Course in Miracles, a self-study course, is for. You're supposed to practice catching your own mistakes. which is what I did. I kept catching my mistakes. I said, wow. And I kept going back. I don't quite understand this. You know, I can't understand this. And you keep admitting to yourself, you're the one that's making mistakes, not Jesus. Okay. So when people say that, you know, that Jesus is their Lord and Savior, hopefully what they're saying is Jesus doesn't make mistakes. I'm the one who's making the mistakes. I'm the one who's confusing things. Of course, a lot of those people will say that, and then promote doctrine, which is confused doctrine. And then saying in the name of saying that this is what Jesus is teaching is completely opposite. So they haven't really gotten their mistakes too very well, actually. So a self-study course is something where your job is to catch your mistakes. Catch your mistakes as you go along. And you will find that there's like an opposition that comes from some deep-seated fear that you have. That twists truth, changes on you. And so then you think you're following truth, but what you're really following is your distorted twisting, which is really following confusion and agreeing with fear. That, yeah, we need structure. Structure is life, we think. Structure is identity, structure is life. God's trying to take away my structure. God's trying to annihilate me. No, no, no. And then you twist it and say, no, God has really all created structure. God is all for structure. God wants me to believe I'm a structured being. God wants me to live in a structured reality. Structured world, structured environment, structured reality. God wants all my experience to be a structured experience. This is what God wants from me. And then you say, oh, I don't feel so frightened, you know. But then there's always something within us that says, well, there's some opposition to this that's coming from somewhere. I don't know. Must be the devil, must be Satan, must be some who's opposed to this structuredness that makes me feel like I exist. No, that's actually God. That's actually the real God saying, no, there is no structure. You're completely free. That is the structure. Pure freedom is the structure. It's the only structure there is. So we get it backwards, you know, and why continuity fear? So repentance for me means accept the fact you're suffering from continuity fear. That's it. Once you accept the fact you're suffering from continuity fear, then you're honest. And then you'll say, okay, I must be making mistakes in service of the continuity fear. So let me be aware and alert to these mistakes I'm making so I can catch them and correct them bit by bit. That's all I did. I mean, when I came across A Course in Miracles, I had all these breakthroughs, spiritual breakthroughs, and I actually awoke from delusion. And then I realized that I couldn't quite sustain it because the fear of sustaining it, I felt like the pull of familiarity with structure was pulling me back, and I got pulled back into the belief in structure again. But I was conscious of being pulled back into it. And I said, this is a mistake, but why am I doing this? Because of familiarity, continuity fear. I'm afraid of no structure. I'm used to this. So I realized I was getting pulled back just because I was used to it. And then I said, and then the Holy Spirit told me, all you have to do is work on this and gradually get familiar with you know, truth. And you'll get free eventually. So then I just repented. I realized, hey, I've got a continuity problem. And that's the problem. That's the real problem I have. I don't have any other problem. I know I can wake up. I already know I can wake up. I already know this is a delusion, dualistic delusion. I already know that reality still exists. I just experienced it. So I don't have any problem, actually. Reality exists. My functionality in reality exists perfectly. The only problem I have is this continuity problem. No other problem. And then I just went to work on it, aware now that I'm going to try and distort things because of this continuity fear. So I began reading A Course in Miracles, and I'd read. Sometimes I'd have to read like a paragraph over and over and over and over, or, you know, a section over and over. I mean, I went read the book over and over and over and over and over, because I'd read it and then I'd start distorting it, you know. I'd say, this must mean this, and I said, wait a minute. Just read what's being said there. You know, don't try and come up with your own conclusion. Or you might start reading something and say, okay, I know what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about this. And you jump to some conclusion. I say, no, wait a minute. Read everything. He says, that's not what he's saying. I kept catching these mistakes I was making, the distortions, leaping to false conclusions, all this stuff. And gradually, you know, eliminated more and more and more and more and more and more of that. So it doesn't happen very often now at all. Rarely. And if it does, I catch it right away. I say, whoa, wait a minute. Yeah, no, that's okay. Iron out, no problem. But this takes time. This takes time. The continuity fear is so severe. Remember, continuity fear means we're used to believing that structure is existence, is being, is identity, is reality, is our functioning. And it actually has absolutely nothing to do with our identity, our being, our functionality at all. Nothing to do with it. In fact, the structures don't even exist. It's a mirage. It's a hallucination. But we're so believe that it is our being, that to see no structure, to experience no structure, we think I can't function this way. I have no idea how to function. So I must be in, annihilation. I'm functionless, which is some sort of horrible, living death or something. This is called the continuity fear, to drop all structure forever and realize that structure has never existed, never will. It freaks us out. So we need to gradually get used to less and less structure, less and less structure, which are these holy instant moments of wowness. When you have this little breakthroughs, it's like, wow, I just heard this, I just hearing this, wow. And then your structure, future structure, it seems like it's not necessary anymore. You lose sight of your structure is what happens. Or at least to some extent, you feel a lot less structured. Okay, a lot less structured. And you get used to this feeling of feeling a lot, like what I am is a lot less structured than before. Now this I is the idea of structure, okay? So you can even experience this false self, this I, is it's not even there, I don't even know where it is. It really means just, I'm no longer identifying with structure as my identity. So it seems like the self has disappeared. It's good, I don't need it to come back. It's just the belief that in structure is all that's happened. So the path takes time. It takes a while to go over and over and over and gradually iron out in your continuity fear, because your continuity fear is definitely going to jump up and distort stuff for you, for sure. For sure. And you may be going along and saying, this is truth, and then suddenly flip it, and lies. And you'll try to combine truth and lies, is what happens. You'll try to combine them. So now we can have co-realities. We can have identity, both identity that's structured, and identity that has no structure. What's the problem with that, God? And you'll start complaining to God, and getting angry, and say, hey, God, that's even better than reality, God. And you've got two realities now. This is what we'll do. So I got two realities, one with structure, one with non-structure. And this is the goddess trap, as I call it. The goddess trap is to promote this idea that we have something superior to reality, and we have now two realities. One that's structured, the mother, body, flesh, form, time, space, process, structure. Okay, now we now have this reality, and we also have the unstructured reality. If you want that, you can have that too. You can get your choice. You can do either one, And so the goddess says, I'm superior to God. I'm giving you choice. You can have both. How benevolent I am. Which is just a marketing device that we're using, the goddess. So this is where we get stuck, because we think, oh my gosh, I can't be without structure. Let me find a really nice goddess who will give me a really good structure, she's better than God, way better than God, because God's so mean. He says, no, there's no structure. And I said, that's not fair. That's not equal. You're not giving equal value to structure and non-structure. You're being discriminatory. You're being repressive. You're not being appreciative. So we then think God is bad. God needs the goddess to balance God out, because God's imbalanced, God's only gives us no structure, whereas the goddess gives us both. How benevolent she is. And of course, this is how we deceive ourselves. This only creates worse continuity fear. And this is what's led us to this terrible debacle that we have in the world now, where the will towards spiritual literacy is been collapsed to such an extent that the final collapse may happen to be like Krakatoa, east of Java, where the cauldron, it collapsed, collapsed, this ocean water got into the, into the magma, and the top collapsed into it, and put a plug into it, and pressure cooker built up, and kaboom, no more Krakatoa. The world is getting ready to have its will towards spiritual literacy collapsed. And they think they have something better. Two realities, both structure and no structure. How great. As co-realities, How fair, how equitable, how enlightened, how advanced, how sophisticated, how inclusive, how tolerant, how non-bigoted, how non-hateful, how wonderful, how, you know, progressive, you know, you see. How stupid, you know, is really what it is. How stupid, how fearful, how confused is really the right way to label this. So, we're on almost the eve of destruction, the eve of Krakatoa, you know, spiritual Krakatoa, which will cause, you know, shockwaves around the world. The Krakatoa explosion was felt all the way around the world. This is really it affected the entire globe, barometric pressure being affected everywhere. And, oh my gosh, it was a global event. So we're about ready to have our spiritual Krakatoa on this planet. The collapse of into compliance. The collapse into compliance. Okay. Now, supernature is not a separate reality. Okay. It's an illusion that Holy Spirit knows. It's the final illusion. It is a symbol. It is the final symbol. It is a symbol symbolizing reality, which is it's structure symbolizing no structure, is actually what it is. Because it's free of process, okay? It still seems to be form, even though it's flimsy, the form, it seems to be radiant with spaciousness and the way it appears, you know, it reminds us of reality, it reminds us of freedom from all structure, you know, that it reminds us of our functioning. It is not an attempt at co-reality at all, okay? This is what the Holy Spirit has for us. It is not an offering of a goddess at all, okay? It is an offering of the Holy Spirit. It's not an attempt for us to say, well, we can have both, let's have both. No, it's a progression of our repentance, saying, I want to get back to accepting reality the way it is. There's only one reality, which is completely free of all structure. I want to get back to that glory. So this is the final means I need, the final crutch that I need to evaporate my remaining continuity fear. And so that is the attitude and approach that we need to take towards supernature, okay? It has nothing to do with the goddess at all. As I say, dump the goddess, see? Thank you, goddess, for everything you've done. Much appreciation, love and appreciation, because that's what I asked you to do. And now, don't need you anymore. Maybe later, but not now, okay? Don't try to, you know, cut it off totally right now, because we still have continuity fear. So we said, well, maybe later, not now, but perhaps later, but right now, definitely, being dumped, don't need you anymore. If it's raining, it must be California now, right? Every day's rain is great, it's amazing, it's incredible. Don't stop. But we're supposed to get a little break coming up. Tomorrow, a little break, Friday, more rain. Then it's supposed to be clear throughout the Christmas season. Christmas holidays. Talk about intolerance, you know, getting rid of Christmas, kicking Christmas out of Christmas. Happy holidays, happy holidays. What you can say is happy Christmas holiday season. What's wrong with that? It's inclusive. Happy Christmas holiday season. Happy Christmas holiday season. Now, when they claim co-realities, okay, you think, what's wrong with that? Well, everything's wrong with it because it's a complete lie and deception. But even more so, their so-called compromise, saying, well, we can have both, is only a temporary stalling tactic they're using. Because ultimately the goal is to get rid of God altogether, get rid of reality altogether. Just, you know, so you could say happy Christmas holiday season. They say, oh, yeah, okay. But what they really want is to get rid of Christmas altogether and just say happy holiday season. So for a while they were saying, yeah, Merry Christmas and happy holidays, right? But where is that now? Nobody says that. They say happy holidays, okay? And I still say, you know, Merry Christmas and happy holiday season. And people look at me like, huh? That's not in compliance. So, you know, if you try out stuff, which I have done over the years recently, to see what people's reactions are, if you're not in compliance, like if you say, hey, happy, Merry Christmas and happy holiday season, just look at their, just notice their reaction. If they say, hey, yeah, you got it. Or they say, like stunned, kind of, hey, you're not in compliance. That's not compliance. They feel like, everyone I come across has a reaction like, hey, that's not compliance. With few rare exceptions. That's not in compliance. This is the reaction people have. That's not in compliance. You're not in compliance. What's the matter with you? And they say, wow, you're kind of a knuckle dragger. You're one of these stragglers late to the party. You didn't get the memo, huh? Their attitude is, whoa, you didn't get the memo. What happened? Maybe you're a little mentally deficient or something. What happened? You know, wow, what's wrong with you? You didn't get the memo. You're not in compliance with this? Come on. This is the reaction that I get. This is the reaction I get. And it's like the point now you don't even want to say anything because, you know, the blowback is so extreme. Very uptight. Very, very uptight. You talk about uptight world, it's this world right now. And I pointed out what's driving the engine. What's driving the engine? You know, continuity fear. Unacknowledged continuity fear is driving the entire situation. Fear of the loss of structure. They think loss of structure or belief in structure. Actually, there is no structure. There's belief in structure. Loss of a belief in structure, they feel is their annihilation, a hideous, eternal death. And so, of course, they're frantic to be in compliance with something that will save them from that, supposedly, which is why they're frantic to embrace cosmic corporate culture. And they are frantically embracing it. And they want to know, how can we embrace it better? Give us more stuff on television, more terrible stuff, you know, so we can even embrace it more. There's no end to their frantic embracing, you know, the clinging. They say, we need this, we need it, we need it. Get rid of these terrible spiritual religious people who are, you know, talking about eternal life and God and heaven and all this stuff, you know. Let's water this down. Let's change this. Let's distort it. Let's twist it. And that's what their, you know, what their agenda is. This may sound like science fiction, but the fact is, this is actually happening. This is what is happening here in this world. This is what is taking place right now. This is a front lines report. This is what's happening in the world. Now, cosmic spiritual culture, what are they going to do about it? They don't want to push us too forcefully because then it'll retreat into fear, of course. Because, again, the fear of have no structure is super, super, super strong fear that we have. Unacknowledged in most people. But if you acknowledge it, you find out, oh, you get help from cosmic spiritual culture. You say, hey, Jesus, I've got this severe problem. I have a severe problem of lack, fear of lack of structure, you know. And so I have this continuity problem. And so I'm afraid of you. I'm afraid of truth. I'm afraid of God. I'm afraid, you know, I'm distorting stuff. So I really need help. Then you get the help. You start getting help. It's called repentance. Repent, 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 for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Of course it is at hand because it has no structure. How could it not be at hand? It's always at hand. Of course. But you won't see it until you repent. You know, see, the structurists think that Jesus is coming here to bring some marvelous structure in the world, you know, to get the structure right. They think the problem is that the structure isn't quite right. But when Jesus returns to this world, Jesus is going to set the structure right and make sure, okay, this is the right structure. He says, here, you'll have this structure forever. Don't worry. You'll have the structure forever. Oh, good. Thank you, Jesus. That's not what Jesus is about. Jesus is about helping solve this continuity problem for us so that we can forgive ourselves and we can evaporate this continuity fear, and so we realize we don't need structure. In fact, structure is actually impossible for us, and that's perfectly fine because we know how to function the way we were created to function, which is as freedom itself. As freedom itself is pure absolute freedom itself, playing with the pure potentiality that is God. Absolute pure potentiality for any and all experiencing we want. Every moment, every option is equally open to us. Every option is equally open to all every moment. Every option is equally open to all every moment. That is reality, and that is our functionality. So that's a far cry from this dream we're having, isn't it? Therefore, continuity problem. So repent, repent, repent. Say, yeah, just admit I have a severe continuity problem. Everybody should be saying that. The idea of these spiritual teachers in this world and blah, they should be repenting too, right? Set the example. They should say, yeah, I have a severe continuity problem. You know, and or that they did have a severe continuity problem and they were able to have completely evaporated, which I'm not really aware of too many in this world, if any, who had really evaporated their continuity problem entirely. So they should be saying, yeah, I'm a, you know, the Christianity is a profession. I am a sinner, meaning I have a severe continuity problem. Okay? I'm afraid of reality. I'm afraid of God. I'm afraid of no structure. And I need to work on this. This is the Christian way. This is the way of the pilgrim. This is the way of all religions should be. It, fundamentally, this is the way. I have a severe problem, a continuity problem. I need to work on it. I need to work on it. I am working on it. I am working on it. There's this teacher. I'm not going to point his name out, but he was a big, big teacher back east, and he was lording it over his devotees, and everyone thought he was enlightened and everything. And he finally admitted that he has some issues, he has some severe issues he needs to work on. You know, it may have been forced upon him, but at least he said, I'm not who I thought I was. Why? He hadn't repented and say, I have a severe continuity problem. Had not seen it properly, you know, so needed to do more work. This is fine. No problem, no worries there, okay? So, we all need to say, you know, I need to keep working on this continuity problem. I need to keep reinforcing this truth. I need to keep hearing truth. I need to keep spiritual literacy going. Now, if you get it at Jesus or Ramana Maharshi or whatever, you know, they don't have a continuity problem, okay? The rest of us do. Some more than others, of course. But the basic profession is the Buddha repentance, humble, repentant, and working on the continuity problem, and sharing whatever clarity we do have, but also recognizing, you know, that we need to, you know, full stop in the wow. That we need to keep working towards freedom from all structure, freedom from the belief in all structure. We need to keep working towards that, absolutely. Christian saints tend to be very humble, very meek, very humble. Good example, actually. They have been good examples throughout history. And there's different styles, you know, different styles. It's the same throughout all religions. And the real saints tend to have this wonderful. They've gone through the path, you know, of struggling with this continuity fear. So they understand the struggle that it is, and they call everyone to this struggle. To be humble, to be meek, to be confessional, to be repentant, to say, I have a severe problem. I have a severe problem. And it's this continuity problem. There's no other severe problem. That's the only one there is. It's the only severe problem we can possibly have. Fear of no structure is the fear we have. There isn't any other fear. That's what we fear. So that's a gigantic fear. Difference between structure and no structure. It's not like we have a little bit of structure. We don't have any. We don't have even the tiniest bit of structure in what we are, what reality is. No structure whatsoever. So it's not a matter of getting to a point where you accept a little bit of structure and say, this is it, this is the ultimate, I've reached the ultimate. That is not true. It may be needed to function here, and if one understands that, that's a different story. But to claim that this is the ultimate is not true. Sri Sri Anandamayi said, the bliss that she had, she said, actually, beyond that, there's even a greater bliss. But she says, if you go into that greater bliss, you cannot really remain here. And Jesus says the same thing, that, you know, accepting pure, direct knowing, you can't do it here. He says, you can't do it. He says, that's okay. No problem. But healed perception is possible here. Healed perception is possible here for us. Absolutely possible. In fact, necessary. We need to do that. But to recognize, it's just healed perception. Healed perception is what it is. It's not final enlightenment. It's healed perception. It's a symbol, you know, the final symbol. But it's still perception. It's still structure. But it's structure that is easy to set down, finally. It's the structure, it's the final structure, final perception that is really easy to set that down. That's what it is, okay. So, that the final structure, okay, that's what it is. So what a wonderful path we have. What a successful path we have. And these videos for me are like somehow I'm able to do this because, again, in the previous life, I was able to do a tremendous amount of composing, give a tremendous amount of performances, put on, you know, these, be responsible for this. So I'm able to share this, like, kind of this spiritual literacy. Share it, and enjoy doing it. It's like playing a piano concerto or something that I enjoy, that the audience enjoys, and it helps elevate, you know. Back then it was musical literacy was what I was trying to elevate. Now I'm trying to elevate spiritual literacy, and spiritual literacy will actually enable us to elevate, to heal perception, which is a perception which is easy to set down, so that we don't need any perception whatsoever anymore. Once we set that final healed perception down, which is supernature, vision of oneness, death-free realm, forgive, true forgiveness, pure forgiveness. And so spiritual literacy, getting familiar with this, helps us out. Be repentant, realize you have a severe problem, continuity problem, that's it, right? What is that? I'm afraid of no structure whatsoever. Forever. No structure, no trace of structure anywhere. Never been, never will be, no trace of any structure. I'm afraid of that. That's the continuity problem. Because we're used to believing that what we are is somehow structured. Not true. Never will be true. We can never make it true. So this whole plan to make this equally true is futile. It's futile. And you'll regret it to the utmost if you go in that direction. You will have the utmost regrets because you will be turned into a slave. You'll be slaving for futility, and the slavery gets very harsh. And you're demanded that you love confusion. And this makes you feel conflicted, and you feel disassociated. You start having mental problems, and then you take drugs for the mental problems. And it gets worse and worse and worse and worse. So enjoy the video. I hope you enjoyed the video, because that's what it's here for. It simply is to be enjoyed. Enjoy it. Say, wow, I really enjoyed this. It's like scintillating, you know, just like, wow. All this different ways of looking at the situation. I'm not used to it, so, you know, this is great. It helps me get used to it. So, again, hope I enjoyed the video, and I hope you enjoyed it too. Okay, very great. That's it.